So our next speaker is Mauro Vallati, and he will talk about embedding automated planning with urban traffic management operations.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, you probably realized I'm not Lee, also because I don't look so smart. So anyway, what are we going to talk today? What's this talk about? This talk is about Simplify, which was a feasibility project in which we tried to use planning for dealing with unexpected traffic condition in a large urban area. You don't have to hold your breath up to the end of this talk. I can, as a spoiler, tell you that the project was a success, and we will see later some of the details. And just provided some hints, the project involved British Telecom, Transport for Greater Manchester, two small medium enterprises, and clearly the University of Huddersfield. And, whoa, sorry, this is the outline of the talk, so I need to provide you a brief background on urban traffic control, then we'll see some exciting work we've been proposed and used from the planning and scheduling community for urban traffic control. Then we will focus on the Simplify project, and we will see some results and future developments. Now, in terms of urban traffic control, we can say that for cutting a long story short, what it is about, it's mostly about controlling traffic lights for dealing with traffic, usually with congestion or rush hours or plan ahead events, things like that. And in normal or expected congested condition, it works pretty well, reasonably well, with a single overall goal, which is to minimize the delay, where in here minimize delay means that every vehicle, you are trying to minimize the delay for every vehicle which is navigating through the area that you are controlling. But really, there are some improvements that seems to be needed and that I think we can probably address as AI or as planning. First, current techniques for urban traffic control need to be able to improve their capacity, their capabilities to deal with unexpected traffic condition. Second, take into account different goals explicitly, for instance, air quality or focusing on specific links, specific areas, specific car parks, something like this. And clearly, since we're speaking about the age of sensors, the age of data, there is a huge amount of sensor data which is available, and we should somehow try to take advantage of that. Having said that, what are the techniques, what are the solutions which are usually and currently in place in urban traffic control, so in our cities? The first one, that is not as the image suggests, that you have a traffic light which is always red, even for usually facing this sort of situation, is using fixed time traffic light phases, which means that an urban expert decided the length of the traffic light phases. Think about two or three settings, like one for rush hour, one for the daytime, and one for the night. And then these settings are used as they have been set, as they've been done, without considering the current situation of the traffic. That's why they are called fixed time. And then we got some reactive approaches, like Scoot and Sketch, which are basically from the 80s, from the 90s. And that can control a small number of junctions which are connected and reacting through their sensors and through their algorithm, which is not very well known, in fact, because it's proprietary. They can react to the condition of the traffic. And traffic experts can set the behavior of these approaches by using a number of parameters which are exposed. And then we have model predictive controls, which has been engineered mainly to control large areas. And in fact, what we observed, or what traffic experts told us, is that they are not really widespread in application, because they tend to be computationally expensive and tend to be slow to converge. So you can use the approaches only when you have some expected condition, and only when you know that the traffic behavior will be in that direction, well ahead. And moving to planning and scheduling approaches, I think one of the most remarkable one is SurTrack, which was basically proposed from this university, and which is actually in place, I think, as a pilot study in an orphan area of Pittsburgh for controlling 50 junctions together. And the idea here is to break down the problem in exploiting a multi-agent approach. So each junction is an agent which can communicate with its neighbors for exchanging information about future traffic demands. And then each agent can fix or can improve its traffic light settings with a goal to reduce the overall vehicle's waiting time. And if we move in the area of planning, one work which was proposed by Lucas Harpa, was led by Lucas Harpa, which is down there, in 2015, has a strong focus on vehicles. So the idea was, let's model each vehicle singularly, and let's say that each vehicle which is entering into the region which is controlled has a communication with the urban traffic control system, maybe through SatNav or through Google or through something like that, so we can tell this vehicle where to go in order to distribute the traffic. The idea works pretty well, but clearly I think you can imagine that there are some scalability issues. So as soon as the number of vehicles grow, this approach cannot be applied anymore. And then we have two other works, which were basically proposed in parallel during the European Coast Art Actions, which are the aim to put together experts from different disciplines to come up with ideas for dealing with traffic situation. And both of them decided to lift up the level of abstraction from single vehicles to traffic flows or to, let's say, relative traffic conditions. So the first one was led by Daniel, which is down there, and exploited. The main difference of these two approaches is in terms of the language. So this first work focused on a PDDL 2.1 representation, which clearly means that there are a lot of planners which can deal with that. And the idea was to use some relative descriptors, some relative predicates, for describing the situation, the congestion of the links inside the area that we are controlling. So you can say that the congestion for a given link is medium, high, or low, or something like that. And then the actions are in place, and in the precondition you have something like, okay, if this link has a traffic situation which is high, apply this action which will reduce the traffic condition on that link, but will increase the congestion on the next roads. And this action will result basically in increasing the green light for that specific link. And then we have the work which was proposed by myself, Daniele from King's, which is down there, Bart De Schutter from Delft Technical University, which was the traffic expert of the team, and Lee McClatchy from University of Huddersfield. And we decided to go for a PDDL plus representation. So we decided to represent traffic flows as processes in which basically you are saying that if a traffic is going through a junction from a link to another link, which can be represented as some sort of liquid, basically, in which vehicles are moving via the junction. And the planner is in charge of deciding how to affect these flows by stopping the traffic light in the junction and move it to the next stage. And building on our experience in that PDDL plus work, which was proposed, which was published in AAAI in 2016, we decided to go for that simplified project, and with two main aims. So clearly, as I said before, the focus was on using planning for unexpected traffic condition. We decided to keep an eye on our quality, basically to checking if by reducing the congestion without explicitly reasoning about air quality, we can have an impact on the pollution in urban areas. And then the other aim, which was not directly affecting us, let's say, as planning guys, but which was developed by other guys in our university, was to semantically enrich all the data which are available so that we can reason upon it. So they were basically dealing with databases, with sensors, with everything which was available, putting things together and provided it to us so that we can represent it in PDDL plus and then reason on that. And the first thing which was, I would say, shocking for me, probably because it was the first project in which I was heavily involved, is that we as academics were not in charge. So these are the different members of the consortium which were squeezing us in the middle of it. So we got Transport for Greater Manchester, which were the problem owner and the experts of the project, British Telecom, which were liaising with Manchester, and which were the data provider for us, InfoHub, Nottingham, which are in charge of the validation, and CamFuture, which were project managers. So you know it's basically someone which is just sending you emails saying you have the deadline and you have to deliver yesterday. And what we were doing in that consortium was basically engineering ACK, a domain model, the original PDDL plus domain model, which was proposed in IIIA 2016, in order to be able to reason and represent an area which was large and interesting enough for the guys from Manchester. And also we have also to dig a bit into the planners, UP Murphy, in order to make it faster for solving problems in almost real time. And okay, that was the original architecture, only considering the planning side. I will not go too much into the details, but the overall idea is that the guys from Manchester has huge databases about what happened in the past, so they have historical data. What we can do is simulate the fact that what happened in the past is happening right now, applying our planning techniques, our planning strategies, and check what would have gone, what would have been the difference between the two. That's for cutting the long story short. And which area did we settle? Basically, an area of Manchester, as you can probably see over there. So this is the center of Manchester, UK. And this is Salford, so we settled for this area. And it is interesting because all the traffic which is coming from the highway, especially in the rush hour in the morning, is going through one of these roads to the city center. So in here you can see in red the junction, which are under our control, and in blue the boundaries of the region. And this is a different representation in which you can see all the links which are connected with different junctions and all the boundaries with the name which were provided by Manchester. And when I said that we had to hack the domain model, I meant that we had really to rethink all the PDDL plus representation, because using the original model that we proposed in IIIA 2016, we were able to model this part down here. So this junction 2002 and the two boundaries. And I can still hear the guys from Manchester laughing about that. But the main problem was that what we initially thought was the bottleneck, that's the number of cars, the number of vehicles, it's not really the bottleneck of approach. The bottleneck is in the complexity of the traffic-like stages, in the complexity of a junction. So for that 1202, you have seven different stages. For each stage, you are activating 4 to 5 traffic flows, and on top of that, you have intergreens between the stages, which means time in which all the traffic lights are on red for allowing cars which were waiting in the middle of a junction to leave. So that was the bottleneck, and that was what we have to address in order to improve the model. And we thought about a number of test cases using historical data, focusing on morning rush hour wherever possible. So clear saturated road, as link as possible. Clear different saturated roads, clear the whole region, or focusing on some saturated road which have some nearby roadworks, with again the overall aim to investigate tailpipe emission savings. And how did we test, how did we validate the results? In three ways. First one was visual inspection. So we had the traffic experts which were taking a look at the plans and says, okay, that makes sense, or no, that's something we wouldn't have done. And as a result, we had that all the strategies generated had the recognizable common sense parts, which basically means if I have to decongest a link, I'll try to maximize the green light for that specific link. Then we use the planner's internal simulator, so we run UP Murphy by telling it that no junction was controllable, and that was generating two different plans. And then we use traffic simulator, SUMO, which is the most let's say academic oriented, and AIM-SUM, which is actually used by Transport for Greater Manchester for checking their plans before putting them in place. And we observed that in general, according to the goals which were set, we were able to clear the areas typically in 25% less time. And so summarizing, and the work demonstrated the possibility and the capabilities of plannings to generate strategies, goal-oriented strategies, within a large urban area. Strategies works for 5 to 30 minutes ahead and are generated in 2 to 30 seconds. which means also almost real time for them. And in terms of emissions, in general, we observe a 50% reduction, even though we didn't explicitly model emissions in our domain model. And as a byproduct, basically, the knowledge representation has been significantly improved. So now it can deal with intergreens, boundary process, roadworks, roundabouts, and a number of other interesting features. From the point of view of the academic achievements, we believe this is the first successful application of AI planning in which we are using real data in a real area, using historical data. And for the future, clearly, sky is the limit. So we're thinking about extending as much as possible the area which can be under the control of a planner. And right now what we are doing is, by the 1st of June, we started another project involving Manchester, in which right now, rather than a feasibility project, we are trying to deploy our planning approach into their, let's say, control room and check how that works. So very likely we will need to deliver by June next year, and we will see. And if you are interested in that, we are opening position. So if you're looking for something challenging, that's probably the right way. And that's it. Thank you.
Yes,
Daniele? One question. We are implementing something in London. Unfortunately, it cannot be published. But the main problem we have to solve is how to model at each junction the flows of vehicles going straight, turning right or left. How do you handle
it? We are basically considering the fact that, let's say, for each link, you have different flows which are moving around. So what we are doing is each flow represents the maximum amount of flow, a maximum of vehicles, which can go in each direction. And this is somehow normalized according to the percentage of vehicles that usually are moving in the different directions. That's the way. For the time that you are considering, in rush hour in the morning from 7 to 8, that's a percentage. Because otherwise, guys from traffic usually deal with matrices, origin-destination matrices. From this, they can extract, or at least what they did, was extracting information for each junction, saying, okay, very likely, in here you have 40% of vehicles which are going straight, 20 on the left, and 40 on the right.
Other questions? Yes?
So, in previous work, you were modeling the delay time between intersections. Are you modeling that now?
Sorry, didn't get that.
In previous work, you weren't modeling delay time or travel time between the intersections.
No, we are not modeling that because in here we are considering congested situation. So you don't consider the fact that if you have a road which is length, 500 meters, the vehicle needs some car to get to the next junction because you think that there are enough cars in the queue. So it is just queuing, and you can ignore this aspect.
I think for a lot of the queues that work, but I'm not sure for every queue that works, right?
No, that's correct. Now, this is quite a strong assumption, and it's a high level of abstraction. We can agree on that. But at least for the scenarios in which we consider that, so if you have extremely congested area, clearly there are some roads that you are modeling very bad. But the main ones usually follow what we are modeling, the way in which you are modeling it.
I'm squeezing one more data question. So you're using the data to model the inflow rates and also turn probabilities, or?
Yeah.
Yes.
So you said you're looking to expand the area you're modeling. Given your current techniques, how big do you think you can scale that up?
That's a good point right now. We don't know. What we are trying to do is, one of the main issues is that all the planners ground before reasoning. What we're trying to do is to reducing as much as possible the number of parameters for each operator and each predicate, and this is already allowing us to push a bit the boundaries on the region I've shown so far. I don't know exactly how far we can push it.
All right, let's thank the speaker again.